Welcome to the last day of Cooper Baptist Church and Vacation Bible School. Thank you for being here, not only this week, but thank you for making time to be here today. Thank you for entrusting us with your children, all those in purple shirts and a lot more like me that aren't wearing purple today. We had a part in just trying to minister God's word and God's love to your child or to your children. So thank you for that sacred responsibility and coming alongside you for a few days. And honored to do that again today. So I'm about to turn it over to Brother Roland, and I think we're going to maybe kind of have a song or two of just kind of our normal worship, and then we're going to turn it over to have our VBS closing program. But again, my name is Rob. I work with the youth around here, my wife Michelle, and we're honored that you're here today. And let's young kid, children, teens, how many of you are glad if your parents are here today? How many are glad you have your parents here today? Say amen. We're glad to have all y'all. Of course, God's word and God's truth is not just for children. It's not just for teens. It's for moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas as well. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for this day. Thank you for a beautiful Lord's Day you've given to us on this last day of VBS. And Lord, I know there's some fun to come and some food to come and just more things like that. But Lord, I pray you'd help us even now just to kind of silence our hearts and quiet ourselves before you. And that, Lord, we pray that the children, they're really not up here performing so much, Lord, for parents. I mean, that's part of it. Lord, ultimately, we're just trying to honor and glorify you first and foremost and be an encouragement to everyone in the pews. I pray you'll help the kids and the teachers to do their very best to that end, and we'll give you all the glory. Lord, we'll give you all the praise, for you and for you alone are worthy of our glory and all of our praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. My name is Brother Roland, and we're going to get started. We have a song this morning for our offering. And if the ushers could come up for this morning's offering, I sure would appreciate it. Any ushers taking up the offer, please come on down. You know, as I've been a part of many VBSs here at the church, and I've really enjoyed it. It's always good to see everyone coming together. I know we got some visitors here today. If you would, there's probably a visitor's card right in front of you in the pew. If you want to fill it out and put in our offering plate, we'd love to have record of you being here this morning with us. So thank you so much for that. And I figured, you know, we could sing when we all get to heaven together. It'd probably be like a day of praise, just like we're praising the day for VBS, praising our Savior this morning. So before we do, Andy, you'd like to pray for the offering? All right.
Dear Father, we come today, meaning, where the child do all things, child lift us up. Jesus, amen. Amen.
All right, let's sing when we all get to heaven.
Sing love and rest, love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing there will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing there will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, What a day of rejoicing there will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory.
All right, this time, turn it over to Miss Liz.
Good morning, good morning. It's so great to see all of you here today, and so thankful that you let us have your children so that we can teach them the Word of God this week, and hope that we have planted many seeds. We had an average of 150, and we had 171 enrolled. Isn't that wonderful? All right. We've also been collecting school supplies and money for our school children here as our mission, and it was a competition between the girls and the boys, and I have a feeling I'm going to get slid down the slide today, but Miss Heather is here, and she's going to give us the winner and the loser, I suppose. So Miss Heather, can you come on up? Holy molies. Okay, girls, we have $142.34. And the boys have $257.96. Okay, I'm good with that. I'll slide for Jesus. How about that? All right. So right now we're going to have our children come, and they've worked really hard. So parents, get your cameras ready. Oh, I'm sorry. No. We do have pledges. This is my first year. Y'all give it up for me. All right. Pledges. Please don't do that. Roll the... Come on, guys. Stand for the pledge, please. One short little video we're going to let you see first before we get the children to singing. This is what it's all about, guys.
What video? What video?
You don't have it? Okay. Oh, what? I don't know why she gave me the mic. All right. So what's our motto today?
Right.
And who knows the verse? Can y'all do the verse? Can you do it without seeing the words? Well, y'all are looking. Close your eyes. All right. Close your eyes. Let's say it.
are we.
Somebody sends a video of a little boy. I didn't do it. I don't know. I guess that's what that is.
Where's it at? Ephesians 2:10. Okay. All right.
What are you doing?
All right, so we're now going to have the children come and do their thing.
He gave us eyes to see the colors that he made. He gave us ears to hear the beautiful music. He gave us mouths to sing praise, to worship his only name. Hands and feet, and for his glory we will use them. He gave us eyes to see the colors that he made. He gave us ears to hear the beautiful music. He gave us mouths.
give his life as a gift to me and you. Only one has ever died and rose again back to life for me and you. Only one could ever face the cross. Only one could ever save the lost. Who can write his name upon our hearts, and who can give our lives a brand new start, and who reminds us who we really are, loves us through and through. That's what only God can do. Reign, Lord of all, and his name is Jesus. Only one is the King, ruler of everything, Jesus. Only one is full of love and grace. Only one is worthy of our praise. Who can write his name upon our hearts? And give our lives a brand new start. Who reminds us who we really are, loves us through and through. That's what only God can do. There is only one who can do what God can do.
To share all that God can do, we'll be aware. choose to lay aside the distractions and pursue the eternal. I have created for you a higher calling, a divine purpose. My hopes and dreams travel with you, my son, and I am ready to lead you. But it is only possible if you will rise up and simply surrender. Surrender to my will and my word. To trust in me with all thine heart and to acknowledge me in all thy ways. Only then will it become possible to accomplish wonders. To become who you were meant to be. Arise.
My name is Rob Fleshman, and my wife at the piano. We get the privilege of working with the teens. We have for these past 3 years, and love them, and so thankful for this opportunity and for a chance to get to work with them. Many of them are regular teens, but a few some new ones, and so we're thankful for that. Thank you for entrusting them to us this time. We do have a song to sing and then a challenge from God's Word, but I hope this will be an encouragement to you. I am going to turn to you on that last stand. It's not a hard song. It may not be a song you're familiar with, but it's not a difficult song. We're going to sing through the first couple stanzas, and then I'll ask your help on the third. It's called Complete in Thee. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians that we are complete in Christ. We talk with the teens about sometimes we just feel like we don't measure up. In fact, oftentimes we feel like we don't measure up. We fall short, and we just never can quite be good enough. And all those that are in Christ are complete in Him. I think the fellows have the slides back there in my in the slide deck. There we go. Thank you. Appreciate each and every one of these teens and praying for them as they go back to school here in just a few short weeks. I invite you to turn your Bibles to Luke 24 for a moment. Luke 24, just for a moment. It's always a difficult task to be the only thing standing between a bunch of awesome people and kids and their parents and food and games. So I will keep this short, but I do want to encourage us and challenge us. We have had a lot of fun this week. The teens was the Blue Bashers versus the Red Bulls. We had all kinds of fun competitions. You can check some of that out on the Facebook page and whatnot. And we're thankful for that. And we did all kinds of things, but the teens got preached to twice each day, and it really was centered around the Word of God. And they listened so very attentively. So thank you for that. I want to read Luke 24 just for a moment. It's a familiar passage in some sense. It's some would call it the road to Emmaus. It's right after Jesus' resurrection. And just want to encourage us from this. If you're able to stand, I invite you to do so quietly. If you're not able to stand, that's okay too. But if you're able to stand, I invite you to do that. Luke 24, verse 13. Luke 24, verse 13. And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs. And then I'm going to skip over to verse 27. Still those same two. This time they've been drawn. Jesus has been drawn into their conversation. So it's these two individuals plus Jesus. Verse 28 or verse 27. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Verse 28, and they drew nigh into the village whither they went, and he, that is Jesus, he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to them. And verse 31, their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while we talked with us by the way, and while he opened us the scriptures? And they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem, and found the 11 gathered together, and them that were with them, saying, the Lord is risen indeed and hath appeared to Simon. And they all told what things were done in the way and how he was known of them in the breaking of bread. Lord, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for these children, their families. We know that we preached last week on children and how to raise godly children for you, dear Lord. We know that children are precious, precious, precious in your sight. But Lord, also, is every mom and dad here? For they too were once a child. And some are still believing in you, trusting in you, and walking in the way you would have for them. Some have known the way and departed from it, but you're calling them back. And some have never known the way, and yet here they are. Help us, dear Lord, and meet with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. If you have your bulletin, you should have a little insert in there just very briefly. I want to share with you three things. The first thought I put down from this passage of Scripture was simply this, that we all have unexpected encounters along life's journey. We all have unexpected encounters along life's journey. Here's was two individuals just walking along the way to Emmaus from Jerusalem. And they did not expect Jesus to show up in their midst, and yet he did. And it brings to mind, sometimes we like to think we're in control. We're maybe in high school. We're like, okay, in 2 years I'm going to graduate high school, and then I'm going to go to, I've got 1 year of college under my belt, so I'm going to go to college for 3 years, and then I'm going to get married, and then I'm going to have 2.6 kids. I don't know how that's possible, but that's kind of the average. I'm going to have 2.6 kids, and we're going to retire. We think we have all of life planned out, and it's good to have plans and prepare and be prepared, but we're really not in control as we think we are, and sometimes we have unexpected encounters. Sometimes Jesus shows up when we least expect it, and we have to be ready to do something with that, to do something with him. Here's two visitors walking along, and Jesus joined them. They didn't recognize him as Jesus, but it was Jesus. And can I just say this, parents and everybody, when we encounter Jesus, we have the same exact responsibility as Pilate did when he encountered Jesus. Pilate asked this question,
What then shall I do with Jesus, which is called the Christ? What shall I then do with Jesus, which is called the Christ? That wasn't just Pilate's question for him to give an answer to. That's a question that every person in this room, young and old, must give an answer to. And when Jesus shows up, even in unexpected moments, we have to be ready to deal with this. And I believe God has put a knowledge in all of our hearts of Him and of Jesus Christ. Ecclesiastes 3 is the great passage on everything being to everything there's a time and a purpose, a time to be born and a time to die. And one of the close of that challenge is this: He hath made everything beautiful in His time, and He also hath set eternity in their hearts. Everybody has a God consciousness of Him. All these kids that were up here, they're not born saved, they're not born Christians, but we're all born with a God consciousness. If you're here today and you don't believe in God, you had to unlearn that, because God put within your heart, God put eternity in your heart. He has that within all of us. And we have a responsibility what to do with that knowledge. And if God is touching your heart even today, don't be like King Agrippa. King Agrippa just heard the best of all preachers throughout history, other than Jesus Christ himself, Paul. And King Agrippa said, after Paul witnessed to him, Paul said, I'm persuaded that none of these things are hidden, King Agrippa. Believest thou the prophets? I know thou believest. He's saying, Agrippa, I know you know these things. God's put these things in your heart. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. I think of Felix as well. The Bible says, when Paul witnessed to Felix, it says, and as Paul reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled, and he answered, go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee. You can mark it down. We never heard from Felix again. You can mark it down. That convenient season to accept Christ never came for Felix. And we have to be a good steward of those seasons when they come. That's why the Bible says, call ye upon him while he is near. The Bible says, harden not your hearts, as in the day of provocation. The Bible says so much more about, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. So we all have unexpected encounters along life's journey. And what to do with Jesus is something we must all give an account to. The second thing I put down from this account in Scripture is simply this: Jesus deserves more than a passing encounter. Jesus deserves more than a passing encounter. In verse 29, or verse 28 says, they drew nigh to the village whither they went. And Jesus, so just picture two other people beside me. The teens and I, we do have a skit. We just decided with time what we'll do another day. But we do have a skit to go along with this. We put together, but envision two others walking along beside Jesus. They get to the house or the place where they were going to, and the Bible says Jesus made as if he would go further. Jesus is going to keep on going as kind of a test. Has this fellowship been just kind of a good for right now, or do you want more of me? And he made as if he would go further, and the Bible says that the two individuals, Cleopas, we know one name, the other one we don't know, it says that they constrained him. They begged him, no, please, stay with us. They wanted more than what they had. They wanted to be a good, they didn't want just that little short time to be it. They wanted more. They didn't know it was Jesus at the time, but they wanted more of him. And he acknowledged their encounter, and he did go in and have fellowship with them. The Bible says when they sat down, in fact, I'll just read it again. The Bible says that in verse 30, it came to pass as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them, and their eyes were opened and they knew him. They didn't know who he was. It was just kind of a passing encounter. They didn't know it was Jesus. But they invited Jesus into their home, and they sat down. They had other stuff going on, but they sat down. They made that a priority to spend time with him. And it was in that breaking of bread that something happened. What, we don't know for sure, but something, their eyes were open, because they weren't operating on their schedule. They made margin in their calendar for Jesus, because he was worth it. He was worth more than just a passing encounter. I don't know what it was or when it was exactly that their eyes opened. Maybe it was the prayer before the meal. The Bible says that Jesus taught with authority, and you can bet that Jesus prayed with authority. Maybe it was as they were there close with him, again, all three at a table breaking bread together. Maybe then and then alone is when they saw the nail-scarred hands and they realized what this man had done for them. Maybe while they're sitting around there, maybe it was just the breaking of bread. Maybe they, maybe that brought to mind the fact that, Jesus once broke bread and 5,000 people got fed with just five loaves and two fishes. Maybe it was the fact that Jesus said he was the bread of life, and something clicked. Oh, it's not just physical bread, he's our spiritual bread. We need bread to be healthy. My wife and I are I think it was driven mostly by me, but she's being a good spouse and going along with it. We're on one of those, they go by different names, keto, paleo, no fun diet. Well, one of those, they go by all kinds of different names, but basically you don't have any carbohydrates, no bread. And your body needs bread. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
It just does. And I'll be glad, well, anyway, well, it's for a season, but our bodies need bread. Can I just say spiritually, keeping in mind the backdrop that Jesus is the bread of life, spiritually, a lot of us, I think, sometimes are on a low, spiritual, low bread diet, a no bread diet. And you were made to need Jesus. You weren't made to be self-sufficient. I know some of you are your managers at your place at work, your A-plus students, your all-star athletes, and on and on and on. But God's made you to be dependent upon him, and we need that bread of life, and we need to yield to that, to give him the glory. So Jesus deserves so much more than just a passing encounter. The third thing I put down is simply this. Don't miss this. A closer intimacy with Jesus alone always yields to a deeper connection and community with others. I don't know how many times I can mess that up. That was at least twice. Let me say that again. A closer intimacy with Jesus alone always leads to a deeper connection and community with others. After they realized it was Jesus, after they had spent time with Jesus, not just a passing encounter, can I put it in today's context? Not just 1.2 times each month at church, which is kind of the average that we Americans go to church today. Not just 1 week of VBS or however long the VBS might be. It wasn't just a passing encounter. They sat down. Their hearts were burning for Jesus, and he was welcome to abide in their house. Once Jesus was in their home and abiding in their house, then their eyes were opened. Then they knew that this was Jesus. And the very first thing they did after that deeper intimacy with Jesus is, it says that they were coming from Jerusalem to Emmaus, which is about 7 miles walking. 7 miles walking. So they're at Emmaus. They have an intimate relationship, intimate time of communication with Jesus. And then Jesus departs. And the first thing they did, the Bible says, is they went back to Jerusalem to have fellowship with the church. And so that's why I say a deeper an intimate, more time that we're alone with Jesus always leads to a deeper connection with other believers. God has wired us that way. God's wired us for community. Some of you find your community not in bad things, not in wrong things, but some of you find your community at work. That's especially men for us. I mean, that was me. We sometimes identify ourselves by our work, and that might be our stronghold. That might be our main community. It's supposed to be a community, just not the main community. Some of you may find your community, some of your kids, on sports teams and travel ball and this thing or that thing. And I played sports in high school, and that can be a good community, but it's a poor replacement for the kind of community here in the local church that God's given us. I can't have sugar on this no-carb diet. I can't have any sugar, so I have to take a stevia. A stevia is a poor replacement for sugar. I want sugar. And any other kind of community we could be involved in that's taking us away from community with the local church, You know, the temptation is, oh, just come back to church, come back to church. Yes, we want them at church, but they've already found some other community. What I encourage people is just get alone with Jesus. If you get alone time with Jesus in your Bible and in your Word, He will lead you back to community in a local church setting, because that's God's plan. And so I would encourage you in that way. So deeper, closer intimacy with Jesus alone always leads to a deeper connection in community with others. Can I ask you this for a moment? There's as we close our time together here this morning and prepare for other things, they were walking on the road to Emmaus. They got to their house. Jesus made as if He would go further. And I believe Jesus would have, I don't think it was just sort of for show. I believe Jesus would have kept right on going, almost like, if you boys are content with a little bit of fellowship we've had, then I guess I'm good. So He made as if He would go further as kind of a gut check to see if they wanted Him to abide in their home. And when we get in the home, it says, did not our hearts burn when He walked with us? I wonder, Mom, Dad, and kids, maybe this week, the past few days, have you had a burning heart experience where God's revealed Himself to you? And here's the question. I hope that's the case. You want more of that. Here's the case. Jesus will keep on going. You're to follow Him. I'm to follow Him. He's not to follow us to all the little things we want to do. If we're His disciples, we're to follow Him. He will keep on going. I believe He made a presence this week in the hearts of our teens and children. And He will keep going if we don't want Him to abide. So have you had just a burn? Are you content with a burning heart experience? And then, okay, that's enough, Jesus. I've done my 1.2 times a church a month, or I've done this. Or do you just beg Him to abide in your home? Is Jesus welcome in your home? The Bible says in Revelation, and that He's always, in this case it was the church, He's always knocking on the door of churches, of homes. He wants to be a part of what you're doing in your home. He wants to be a part of all that we're doing here at church. But Jesus is a perfect gentleman. He could, but He will not force Himself against anybody's will. So are you content to have just a burning heart, a passing time with Jesus? Or do you demand that He abide alone? We talked earlier about King Agrippa saying to Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. It brought to mind these words that I'll close you with. This was a song that I sung in a very traditional church when I was growing up. I really haven't sung it probably since then, but maybe some of you will recognize it. And again, I'm not going to sing it, but I will say some of the lyrics. Almost persuaded now to believe. Almost persuaded Christ to receive. Seems now some soul to say, go, Spirit, go thy way. Some more convenient day on thee I'll call. Almost persuaded harvest is past. Almost persuaded doom comes at last. Almost cannot avail. Almost is but to fail. Sad, sad, that bitter well, almost, but lost. Be now persuaded, O sinner, hear. Be now persuaded, Jesus is near. His voice is pleading still. Turn now with heart and will. Peace will your spirit fill. O turn today. Can we have every head bowed and every eye closed just for a moment? If you're able to stand, I know you've stood a time or two. If you're able to stand, could I ask you to stand one more time just for a moment? Every head bowed and every eye closed, children and teens and adults alike. Brother Roland's going to sing a song of a hymn of invitation. VBS may just be for kids. Now listen to me, VBS may just be for kids. And teening night is just for our youth. But Jesus is for everyone standing here today, and even those that aren't able to stand. We never get too old. We never get past a mark where we don't need Jesus. And if you've had a burning heart experience today, praise God for that, or this week. But Jesus wants more than a passing encounter. He wants to abide in your house. The altars are open to my right and to my left. If you'd like to come, we're here to counsel, but just maybe you've known Christ, but you've gotten away from Him, as we all can, and most of us have. At least the one speaking would say that. What a better time than right now to come back and have Him abide in your home. You come as we sing Trust and Obey.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. Let us do His good will. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but it's blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows, for the joy He bestows, are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Thank you once again for being with us today. We've truly enjoyed having each and every one of you here with us. In just a moment, we're going to have lunch for everybody. If you've enjoyed the food at VBS, go ahead and say hallelujah. Yeah, food's good. And if you like the food, I think we're resuming intake on Wednesday, which means we're going to have some food on Wednesday nights. Everyone's welcome, adults, kids, of all ages are welcome. We have a meal on Wednesday nights. We have ministries on Wednesday nights as well. Starting at 5:15 is the meal, and 6 o'clock starts the ministries. We have ministries for teens and children, and we have a Bible study and a prayer meeting for adults. So we'd love to have you starting on the 3rd.